Well, as Nancy said, we are in Uppsala, Sweden, which is just north of Stockholm. And I think I have put up the... Now, one of the things that I love to remind people of when I talk about Sweden is that it is not Switzerland. Very important to remember that. They get confused very easily, as do most of my family members still think that I'm in Switzerland. They always ask me to bring home chocolate and things like that. The good news is Sweden has good chocolate, so that furthers the confusion. We are in a town called Uppsala, which is the arrow that you see on your screen there points to a town called Stockholm, and we're just north of that. It's a city of about 250,000 people with a university of about 45,000 people. It's the fourth largest city in Sweden, country of 9 million people, and we are on latitude with Anchorage, Alaska, so it's dark and cold in the wintertime and wonderfully light and mild in the summer. We came back for 6 months, and everyone in Sweden asked, why are you going back during the summer? To which we replied, we didn't really have much of a choice. The government made us leave for 6 months, but that's a different story. Now, we work among university students, and the reason we do that is because if you work with university students, you find the leaders of tomorrow. And so we want to make sure that the future is bright, so to speak, for Sweden, and that believers are people are coming to Christ and leading their nation to Christ. Now, what is the spiritual climate of Sweden? One day, I'll tell you a quick story that I think explains that very well. One day, Victoria and I went and talked with three students at the university campus. And two of those students were female. One was a guy. That's what happens when you have two who are female. And we started talking to them, and we asked them the question, have you ever met a Christian? These are 26-year-old students. And their answer was no. I've never met a Christian. Now, in a country where the evangelical church is 3% of the population, okay? Now, we all know that this is wonderful Christian people who are in the evangelical church. We assume that most people are Christians within our walls, but that's not always the case. So actual number of Christ followers in Sweden is very low, less than 3%, I would say. And these students had gone their whole life, 26 years of their life, and had never actually met a Christian. They certainly are the first people to ever have the privilege of sharing the gospel with most of the people we met. But we also have the privilege of being the first Christians that most students have ever met. You're more likely to hear the gospel in sub-Saharan Africa today than you are in Northern Europe. And that's just a fact of the matter. And so sitting here today in a Swedish denomination from its roots, and having the privilege of going back to Sweden, it's a tall order. One of the things I want to personally thank you all for is that I know many of you in this room labor on our behalf. We receive notes, we receive word from Anne-Marie and Calvin that you're praying for us. And I can't tell you how much that makes a difference in our life and in our ministry, to know that you have hit your knees time and time again, that the word would go forth and that Christ would be evident in our lives.
I just had one other quick question.
Yes.
Here with the students. What do you think went on in Sweden to make it such a non-Christian country?
I think there's several things. You know, the Bible says that the sin of the fathers is passed on to the third and fourth generation. And I think the biggest thing is that people stopped telling their children and giving them the ability to believe. That's one of the things you give your children, is an ability to believe. And so when that happened, I think you see the decline, is that people stopped. It became a personalized faith. So a secularized society lent itself to privatization and became private. I think the last thing is that the church said, this is getting really hard, and so they withdrew into protection mode and threw up very high walls so that they wouldn't get affected by the world. And so instead of becoming salt and light, they withdrew and lost their saltiness and lost their light.
Now, did you hear what he just said? That's worth the whole day, just a couple of sentences. Let's pray. Father, this is heartbreaking. And yet, at the very same time, so explanatory about what went on in a country that our denomination has its roots. I pray that as we've been talking, even just in the last couple of weeks on this matter, that we would be very much ones who are declaring your power to the next generation. Pray, Father, that you'd bless this couple as they're working in a difficult place. And yet how special to find out that you redeem out of every tribe and tongue and nation those who are your own, there is no culture that is too opposed to who you are that you cannot work and reign. So we ask that you would use them, that you'd raise the support they need, you'd keep them encouraged, and that you would particularly be working in the lives of some of these who are right on the verge of coming to know you as Savior. So we lift them up to you, and we do it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, I've been trying to share with you that you are the grandparents in the household of faith. And in many ways, you are the most important ingredients in the household of faith. Well, granted, we need to have young people and babies being born and all the rest, so the next generation is raising. But Barrett, as he was talking to us about what's gone on in Sweden, it's really clear if we do not, as the older generation, declare God's power in believable ways to the younger generation, it's all going to be over. Josh McDowell has written a book called The Last Christian Generation. And in his book, he says, if we don't get serious, ours will be the last Christian generation in the United States. It's frightening. And so part of what I'm hoping you understand is that this is really true. And if it is, then we pray what David prayed in Psalm 71:18. Even when I am old and gray, do not forsake me, my God, till I declare your power to the next generation, your mighty acts to all who are to come. Now, one of the things I have to tell you, having worked in the geriatric field now for over 20 years, that I find that older people really miss this. And many times, the goal of the older person is just somehow I'll make it to the next day, get through the next surgery, get through the next loss, somehow just to be able to hang on. Scripture says we are raised up by God to declare God's power to the next generation. And that involves two parts. One part is to create enthusiasm for the things we know to be true. And number two, to declare with significance where we see our culture missing God's truth. So this is the prayer. And one of the things we've been sharing the last couple of weeks is one way we do this is to bless those around us. And so we've been sharing a little bit the ideas and the ingredients of what a blessing is. And we said the meaning of blessing is to receive the benefit of God's pleasure. I wondered, as you think about the people you value and have influence over, are you desiring that they would receive the benefit of God's pleasure? Well, let me take a step back and ask an even more foundational question. Do you believe that the pleasure of God is valuable? As you think about your list of things you're giving your life to, that you pray for, that you're concerned about, how essential is the pleasure of God? Is it something you long for? Is it something you value? And if you do, do you want it for those who are in your life? All right, we went on to say that the meaning of blessing is to give approval, honor, encouragement, and refreshment. It's to bring someone into the promise of the unlimited resource of Almighty God. You ever been able to do that? I have to tell you, because I'm a pastor, I guess, I've had great opportunities, often at the hospital, when somebody has just reached the absolute bottom, and to bring them back into the presence of the Lord and lift them back up again, it is so special. And that's what blessing somebody is all about. It's to bestow the favor of God on someone. That's what it is to bless someone. To identify and affirm God's call on another person's life. Now, I don't think there's really a higher calling than that. When you think about those ingredients, that's a pretty amazing thing to be able to do. If that's what blessing somebody is all about, my question is, number one, do you desire to do it? Number two, do you know how to do it? And number three, are you doing it? Well, we're working on that middle part, on what is it to give a blessing? How do you do it? And we said in this long sentence that it is using the promises and commands of Scripture, verified out of your life experience. In other words, the commands and promises of Scripture somehow have validity because you can testify to them out of your life experience. And under the direction of the Holy Spirit, we declare God's truth into another person's life. And it includes five ingredients, and we've looked at two of them so far. The first one is godly touch. I'm not going to review that today. We've looked at it in detail already. Second one is a spoken message or using your words. Now, just to remind you where we were, we said to bless somebody with your words means to speak God's word as a blessing. And I've tried to tell you that to share just your own words can at best be a cliche. Don't worry, be happy. Now, if you tend to be a worrier, that only doesn't help, it makes it worse. And so often if we say, well, smile, things could be worse, and then they usually are. So what we want to do is to say, how do we speak God's words into people's lives so that those words that Scripture says itself have power will bless them? But then we went on last week to say, not only is it speaking that's involved in blessing, probably the most neglected of all is it's listening. You cannot truly bless a person if you don't know how to listen to them. And you are to listen with the ears of God, and then you can bless and be blessed. And so much of our listening is wrong. We've talked a lot about, we are, and I'm still amazed at this, so quick to take offense. I'm just amazed. I've experienced it. I'm sure everyone in this room has. When you've said something so incredibly innocent, and somebody takes it and twists it, and they make something horrible out of it. You never intended it that way. You never even thought of it that way. And I've had that happen many times. Part of the problem is when you speak publicly, like I do, you have all the words out there that people can take offense at. Sometimes it's nice just to be quiet, don't you think? But then they're offended because you haven't spoken to them. All right, so we're so quick to take offense. And Scripture says, be slow to take offense. How does that happen? It means that you interpret the very best possible interpretation of what somebody says to you. And I teased with you when we were talking about this, that the husband comes to the wife and says, boy, honey, you look nice today in that dress. And she said, well, don't I always look nice? You get the idea. I mean, we could use so many examples. So the issue is, are we listening with the ears of God, slow to take offense? Well, the other side of that, the flip side of it then, is that we are quick to forgive. And if somebody has offended, either intentionally or unintentionally, we quickly forgive. All right, then we said we have to have the attitude of Christ for both of those things to take place. And I love this verse. I shared it with you last week from Job 16:5. I would strengthen you with my mouth, and the moving of my lips would encourage you and bring relief. So my question was, what do people expect when they see your lips moving? That's just an amazing verse. And I trust that it will summarize what you want to do. Well, I want to spend just a minute with you now looking at the place of the Holy Spirit with our words, because there's no way we'll pull this off without the ministry of the Holy Spirit helping us. In Ephesians 4:30, we've looked at this verse already, it says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. And that's within the context of not letting in any unwholesome words come out of our mouth. In Galatians 5:16 to 26, it says, so I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. And then in that passage, he lists the acts of the sinful nature: hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissension, factions, envy, and a whole bunch more. And he contrasts that with the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And then he has this powerful phrase, let us keep in step with the Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit that will guard what comes out of our mouth. And out of our mouth comes either blessing or the opposite of blessing. And so he says, let us not become conceited, provoking one another and envying one another. And then in Colossians 3:16, it says, let the word of Christ dwell in you. How? Now that's such a profound phrase, to dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom. And I really like this one in Philippians 2. It says, do everything. Oh, there's one of those words again. Do everything without complaining or arguing. That's just an amazing phrase. Especially when you put those two words together, complaining, arguing. Now, when that's fulfilled, it says, you will become blameless, pure, children of God without fault in a crooked and depraved generation into which you shine like stars in the universe as you hold out the word of life. I wonder if we took a poll of the people that you know, and they gave you a score on 1 to 10, and the score said, how often do these people speak words of life to you? Where would you fall on the score? Are our words life-giving? Or are they damning? Are they discouraging? Are they defeating? Are they distracting? What do our words do? Scripture says, holding out the word of life. Well, as Scripture says, the secret to this, Ephesians 5, 18 to 21, is be being filled. Now, in English, we don't talk that way, but in Greek, it really says this clearly. It's talking about a continual process of being filled with the Holy Spirit. Jesus talked about the Pharisees and how horrible they were, the religious leaders of his day. And he said, people bump up against you, and when they do, what's in your life spills out on them. You ever notice? When you're in a good mood, somebody bumps up against you, you respond usually in a joyous, nice way to them. If you're in a grumpy mood and somebody bumps up against you, what happens? Let me just tell you one thing, if you don't know this already. I say this every once in a while, it scares people half to death. What you are today, you will be in the extreme as you get older. What you are today, you will be in the extreme when you get older. If you're grumpy today, look out. As I've worked in this field, often I'll work with older people, and I've met some horribly grumpy people that probably even used to use stronger language than that. Interesting to me that I'll often ask the children of those grumpy people, has your mother always been like this? And they'll say, well, kind of, but not as bad. I've heard that over and over and over again. And so Scripture's telling us that what's on the inside is what's going to come out. If you're just trying to control your tongue, you're not going to accomplish anything. It's out of the life the mouth speaks. Now notice what Scripture says then. If we are filled with the Spirit, what's going to happen? We're going to speak to one another in musical language. I like this. Psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Singing and making music in your heart to the Lord. Always giving thanks to God the Father for everything. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. So I'm wondering, are people, when they see your lips moving, anticipating words of life? And are they coming out of a life filled with the Holy Spirit? Well, in 2 Thessalonians 2, 16 and 17, there's one of these blessings, and I'm just going to review a couple of these with you. These are the kinds of words that should be coming from our lives if Christ lives in us. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage and strengthen you in every good deed and word. You ever talk like that to people? Now, it doesn't have to be quite that language, but the tone is there. Are you saying to people, you know, I've really been praying that God would build you up, that God would encourage you? Here's another one, Romans 15, 5 and 6. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Jesus Christ, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Have you ever stopped anybody who is in a conflict, Christians and said something like this to them? I'm just really praying that instead of the conflict that seems so often between the two of you, that there would be this harmony between you that would cause people to glorify Jesus Christ. Or Romans 15, 13, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so by the power of the Holy Spirit you might abound in hope. Now, if you need some blessings, there's a number of them right there. Those are the words we can use to bless one another. So we've said it is a godly touch and it is godly words. Now let's look at the third ingredient of blessing. It's the blessing of biblical identity. Now my question is, what makes a person valuable? I don't know, have you ever said to a grandchild or a great-grandchild, "You so incredibly value to me, and here's why"? Where's that value coming from? Well, for the world, it's conformity to empty standards. And it's amazing to me to find out what those standards are, but the Bible calls them empty. 1 Peter 1, 17 and 18, "Since you call on a father who judges each man work impartially, live your lives as strangers here in reverence fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver and gold that you were redeemed from," here's the phrase, "the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers." So much of what we give our lives to is absolutely empty. Scripture talks about the fact for the Christian, what gives us value is our conformity to the person of Christ. So my question is, as you're encouraging each other, your children, your grandchildren, and for some of you blessed ones, your great-grandchildren, are you thanking them, blessing them, causing them value, calling them valuable because of what you see in them spiritually? Romans 12, 1 and 2 says, "Therefore I urge you, brothers, in the view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy," and then I love this phrase, "and pleasing to God, which is your spiritual act of worship. And do not be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." Now I want to say this carefully because I don't want it to sound like it's bragging, because it's not. I'm just as sinful as every other man. But I was never tempted as a teen to smoke. You know why? Because I didn't want to. And I didn't buy the stupid lie that most of my friends bought, that the only way you can be mature, to be an adult, is to smoke. You know where that came from? It came from the tobacco industry. You know what it leads to? Lung cancer. I met with a lady in the hospital this week, and she never smoked, but she grew up in her home where her parents did. They were both died of lung cancer, and she's having emphysema problems. And that's where the empty way of life will come from and lead to when you follow what the world says. And I'm so grateful that God has caused me to say, no, I want to be conformed to the image of Christ. I don't care too much what anybody else says about anything else. And I have found that without exception, the way of life that Christ lays down for me is so much better than anything the world ever has to offer. I was kind of amazed this week. I was listening to a teleradio program, not too important in the details of it, but it was talking about this wonderful retreat that men can go off to, and it's supposedly at least spiritual, run by some Christians, and they were saying how neat it is to go and drink and smoke cigars together. And I'm thinking, I can't believe this. Now, Ruthie and I have never drunk, and we're much wealthier because of it. And I'm not saying, although I would appreciate it, that Scripture doesn't say you can't drink. But what's so amazing to me in our culture, that wine and alcohol is taking more and more and more and more prominence. It doesn't lead to anything good. And then if it's the same thing, it just blows me away, is the whole marijuana thing now. There's so many empty ways of life that you get the latest fad, this is the best thing to do. And Scripture calls it an empty way of life. Now the question is, are we valuing any of the things that the scripture calls empty, often at the expense of what scripture calls really valuable? So what do the people around you think you value in them? That'd be really fun. Matter of fact, I'd even suggest this as a great question as a grandparent to your grandchildren. If you get an opportunity, ask them, what do you think I value in you? And one of my favorite things to do with my grandsons, and you've met them a couple weeks ago, you saw them, we did some things together. And I have historically, even when they were little kids, been asking them questions. It was my favorite thing to do. And when I would visit in their home, they would climb into bed with me when they were little, and it was Grandpa, ask question time. And I'd be asking them questions about what they were doing. Now we sit around the couch, and we're talking as really young adults now with Grandpa, but the questions are still coming. And what's really neat to me is that I've been trying to draw out in them, in their, my questions, what they should really value as a Christian. And I think you'd find, if you talk to John and Josh, that you'll say, Grandpa values our walk with the Lord above everything else. So, what do people think you value about them? What do they do for you? Is that why you value them? Because they make you feel great as a grandparent? And we often say, and again, it's one of these places where I wish we weren't saying things like this, it's so nice to be able to love them and then give them back to the parents. Do you realize what that's saying? It's saying they're really not that valuable. They're a nuisance, but we can put up with them for a little time. I think that's horrible. All right, so do we value them for what they do for us? Or do we value their achievements? Now, right now is the end of the school year, and they're getting grades and awards and the like. And how hung up are we on stuff like that? Now, I have two very bright grandchildren. They're usually setting the curve for everything. You get all the awards for stuff, and I'm very grateful for that. But I've said to both of them, boys, that's not what gives you value. I'm glad you're being good stewards of what God's doing with you, but that's not what gives you value. Is it their possessions? Is that what you value? You go to your kid and say, oh, you know, I'm so proud of you for this beautiful car you drive. I love the clothes you wear. It makes me feel really proud as a grandparent. I love your house. I'm so proud that you live in that neighborhood. Do you value people because of their possessions? How about your friends? A lot could be said about that. How about just their agreement, that you value them because they agree with you? Well, we could talk a lot about these things. How about their external attributes? Honey, you are so beautiful. Well, you know, when you get older, that beauty is in jeopardy. Although scripture says the inward beauty is reverenced by the God and it doesn't fade. So what are we looking at in terms of their external attributes? Or how about this one? Do we value them because of their fun factor? Oh, I have so much fun when I'm with you. Well, I do. I have lots of fun with my grandchildren. But is that what we're valuing? So fill in the blank. If your grandchildren said to you, or you said to them, I am valuable because, what goes in the blank? I really encourage you to do this work. Think about it for yourself and the people that you value. I am valued because of what I do, of what I have, of my accomplishments, of my abilities. I am worthy of love because. How do you fill in the blank? What is your thinking and what is your practice? To bless someone is to attach their value to their identity in Christ. The world is so big on self-esteem, and it's the God of the day. To the Christian, it's Christ's esteem that gives us value. To bless someone is to see them as Christ sees them and treat them as he does. To bless someone is to bring them to see and to live in their value in Christ. To bless someone is to declare God's truth when they have come to believe Satan's lie about themselves, and then this most important phrase, and refuse to be dismissed. One of the things you'll find is our culture these days wants to dismiss you, the older person. That you're old, over the hill, in the way, fuddy-deddy. Let me tell you, you have a value to give to others that nobody else in culture can do. And to be able to say, I refuse to be dismissed. And so as you attempt to reach your sons and daughters with your concern for the gospel, you have to be under the direction of the Holy Spirit, but you refuse to be dismissed. That's what's happened in Sweden. The culture has dismissed the gospel. They won't even talk about it anymore. They don't even know anything about it anymore. We're headed the same way as a culture. Are you strong enough to refuse to be dismissed? And you see the wonderful thing about it? As a grandparent, you can get away with it. People will make room for you that they don't make room in other kinds of way. So how do we communicate godly value to those we bless? Well, the first of all is our attitude toward them. Do they know that as we look at them as human beings, that we're valuing the things that God values? This is an interesting way to look at it from Matthew 25, verses 41 to 46. Then he said to those who are left, depart from me, you who are accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. They also will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you? And he replied, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did not do for the one of the least of these, you did not do for me. And then you'll go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. It's amazing to me how we just kind of don't even see people. We don't value people as Christ values them, and so they're just invisible. There's been lots of studies done about people who have studied this field, and they'll dress up like a homeless person, trying to blend in as much as they can to a culture. And whereas before they were very influential because they dressed differently, smelled differently, acted differently, people just ignored them. Do we value people as Christ wants us to value them? Too often our words of value are only linked to performance. We need to learn how to value people as Christ does. So how do you see the people around you? Especially the people you have influence over. You ever call them a ding-dong? I don't know, maybe you don't use that phrase. Ruthie used it just the other day again. And she and I have used it on the freeway. You, ding-dong. And I got to tell you, that's not a term of endearment. Now, even worse, do we call people stupid?
Yeah.
Or something like it? You ever told somebody they're valueless or had in your mind no value for you, worthless? Do we see people as creations of God? Now notice here, there's going to be three phrases and they're going to build one on another. This is the first. Do we really see people as God's creation? I have in my backyard right now a possum in my trap. He has been destroying my backyard, so I am going to send him to Possum Heaven. Or the other place that Possum goes, perhaps. But I've got to tell you, there's part of me that feels uncomfortable with this. Because that's something God made. I cannot do this just lightly. Now, I'm not an animal rights person, and I don't think Christians should be. But we need to value the things that God has made. But most importantly, the people around us, a creation of God. But there's a second one. This goes a deeper level. Someone for whom Christ died. I And then the one that's the most important, someone in whom Christ lives. Now, we'll relate to every person on one or the other of those three levels. A person who we don't even know at all, know nothing about, we at least value them as a creation of God. The second level is one for whom Christ died, and if the person claims to be a Christian, it's one in whom Christ lives. So Proverbs says, "He who opposes the poor shows contempt for their maker, but whoever is kind to the needy honors God." How are you doing in the value level? Philippians 1, 3 to 11, "I thank my God every time I remember you." I wouldn't dare ask this, but I'd like you to think about it. If I ask you to raise your hand today, and I said, "All right, I want you to look around the room. Can you say about every person that you see here, I thank God every time I remember them?" I wonder if you could raise your hand. Please don't. My guess is we wouldn't say that about every person in the room. Now, we might say it about some, but I think the degree of our maturity in this level is where I say, "I thank God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray for joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Being confident of this, that he, God himself, who has begun a good work in you, will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. And it's right for me to feel this way about you, since I have you in my heart. For whether I'm in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in the grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affections of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and be pure and blameless until the day of Christ Jesus, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God." That's how Paul talked about the people in his life. You see people like that? Do you talk about people like that? Do you pray about people like that? Genesis 49, 28 says, "And this is what their father said to them when he blessed them, giving each of them the blessing appropriate to each individual person." Do you value people so much that you're saying, "God, direct me to know how to bless the people around me"? All right, so we bless one another in the way we encourage or discourage them. We bless them in the words we use to either encourage or discourage them. In the very words, we bless them in the subjects of our value. Do we value their godliness or only their performance? Are we valuing their character? This matter of value and blessing comes in the tools we use at our means to be able to bless others. And how do we do that? And how are we using those tools, our money, our time, our words, our acceptance? And the way we, this one is so important, and the way we talk about them to others. Do you realize that in one sense, what you say about somebody else to another person is more important than what you say to the person themselves? Especially if they ever get a chance to eavesdrop on what you say. I don't think anything gives somebody a greater blessing than to hear somebody talking about them when they don't even realize they're there. At the same time, it can be so incredibly hurtful when you said something horrible about a person and you didn't think they were there. Number 7, in the way we pray for and with them, in the way we listen to them, in the way we share with them, and in the choice of our resources that we're investing in them. So many of these things are practical implications about how we're blessing people. Well, this really brings us then to the fourth of the five pieces. Blessing is picturing a God-defined special future. Now, you will find that many people will say life is a series of problems. Well, Scripture says, "Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that it is worked within us." which is it for you? A God who can do more than we can ask or imagine? Or life is a series of problems? What are you picturing in terms of somebody's future? Now, things are getting tough. There are hard times ahead, but how are we looking at them? Are we under God's direction in affirming God's call on the people that we bless? Do we see the gifts and abilities that God has given to people and match them with his inexhaustible resources to help spur them on? You ever come up to somebody and say, you know, God has so blessed you with this ability, I'd like to encourage you to use it. Let me give you a couple of examples. When I was in high school, I've told you about my speech coach. I would have never have chosen to be in Bob Sanders' class. But he brought something out of me that changed my life forever. I felt called to be a pastor about the same time I met Bob Sanders, and he taught me how to speak. Before that, I was so shy, I would never say a word anywhere. And he said, John, I want you on the speech team. Changed my life. I will forever be indebted to this man, not a Christian. And then I've told you a little bit when Ruthie and I had pastored a church, and we left that church and we were bleeding all over the place because it had not gone well. And my father-in-law said to me, John, have you ever thought how good you are with older people? Again, a radical change in my life that set a whole new course for the last 20 years because of a phrase he said. Or let me give you another one. If you're encouraging younger children, are you giving them purity rings or condoms? And you see, our culture says, you're stupid, you're captive to your desires, and so here's this condom to keep you out of trouble. Do you realize how little we value our young people? And you talk about being offended. I'm offended at our educational, so-called educational system, that they would say this to people. So are we giving purity rings or condoms? The danger, you see, is we can look at the flaws of another person and declare their future. You're never going to amount to anything. And many of you have that mark to this day. Blessing people is so different. What are we trusting God concerning for in terms of those we want to bless? Well, I love the way Jeremiah says it, let not the wise man boast of his wisdom, or the strong man boast of his strength, rich man of his riches. Let him boast about this, that he understand and knows me, for I am the Lord who exercises kindness, righteousness on the earth, and in these I declares the Lord. Are we blessing, encouraging those who know and understand God? Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans I have for you. You know this verse. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and find me when you seek me with all your heart, and will be found by you, declares the Lord. And I will bring you back from captivity. So are we picturing a future for those we bless that has Christ's fingerprints all over it? Well, the fifth and last of the traits of blessing is an active commitment to fulfill that blessing. You see, it's one thing to say, bless you, Jerry. It's another thing to say, I want to bless you. Here's what I'm asking God to do, and everything I have is here to help it be fulfilled. Hebrews 10, you get the example from the Lord himself. This is the covenant I will make with them after that time, says the Lord. I will put my law in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds, and their sin and lawless acts I will remember no more. Do you see what he's saying? He says, I'm going to assume the responsibility to give them a heart to follow me. Or John 14, Jesus said it, in my Father's house are many mansions, rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'm going to come back and take you with me, that you may be where I am. You see, Jesus is very involved in preparing the place where we're going to experience his blessing. So what are the ingredients of active commitment? It's recognizing and appropriating the provision of the Lord. What has God given to allow this blessing that I'm asking God to place on a person to come about? I love this, Genesis 28. It says, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, the God of Isaac. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to the land. Now notice this, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. you have that same commitment to those you bless? Are you saying, I'm here for the long haul? I want to see God fulfill this blessing I've given. A second way that the act of committing is involved is Holy Spirit-directed prayer, that I'm really aggressively praying for people who I'm blessing, that I search and share the Scripture to enable the blessing. Where are the promises and commands of Scripture that relate to the thing that I'm blessing the person for? And then the promise with word and deed to be involved in the fulfillment of the blessing. How can I see this come about? What resources has God given to me to contribute to the blessing I'm wanting to give to the person? And then I really am committed to this one. Be aggressive in your battle for blessing. Recognizing dealing with hindrances to it, the compromise to it, and the robbery of it. So many people are settling for something less than God's best. How can I be aggressive in my battle for the blessing for the people that I'm loving, especially my grandchildren and great-grandchildren? So let me give you just one example. How do you do a blessing? Let's say the person you want to bless is very fearful and anxious. Well, you search the Scripture to find what Scripture has to say about it. And these are a couple of verses that you probably would use. 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And then in 1 John 4:18, it says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear. Now, if you use our Numbers 6 blessing that we've been talking about these last 4 weeks now today, number 5, you fit those verses in this blessing. Here's what it would sound like. May the Lord God bless you and keep you from the torment of fear and anxiety. See what we're doing here? So you're saying the Lord bless you and keep you, but particularly now for the thing you're asking about, from the torment of fear and anxiety. May he cause his face to shine upon you with his power, love, and a sound mind, coming out of 1 Timothy 1:7, and give you grace to overcome fear through his perfect love. See how we plugged that verse in there? May he lift up his countenance upon you with assurance that he will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus as you tell him every detail of your need in earnest and thankful prayer. Now, a couple of weeks ago, on the back of the notes, I gave you a bunch more suggestions. I'll bring those again next week and put them on the back of the notes so you can see them again. But I want to really encourage you to be people who are blessing. Next Sunday is Father's Day. I'm going to talk particularly to grandfathers. And I want to apply this truth to you men. There'll be something for the ladies too. But let me end with this. The Scripture says in Psalms, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all my inward being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not his benefits. May I suggest to you that in reality, if you're living in a blessing of the Lord and to the Lord, you're going to be that way to others. So I invite you to listen then to this song, Kyle. And this is the one we read aloud a couple weeks ago because I didn't have it for you. But I love the words of this. And I ask you, is this the character of your life?
Bless your name forevermore.
invite you to join them on this chorus and sing it a number of times. Participating with your friends around you, calling out that truth that we bless the name of the Lord together. Well, next week we're gathered back, and man, I'm going to call you to a special task of this, but I trust this week we'll be mindful about these five traits of what it is to bless people. The touch, the word, and I'm forgetting the third one. What is it? I can't remember the third one. Picturing a future and committing then your life to the task of that blessing. So that's what we're trusting you'll do. Let's pray and ask the Lord to help us do these things. Lord, thank you that it's not so much remembering the details of what it is. It's a character of life out of which we start by blessing you and live out of the blessings that you've given to us. And then that our words and our lives and our ears are all given to be able to bring the blessing of who you are into the lives of the people who are around us. Help us, Lord, to be the grandparents of blessing. And I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.